Right, we are calling ourselves to order. It's 9:30, March 15th, and this is the once every 3 week business meeting of the Salt Spring Trust Committee. I'm Sheila Malcolmson, I'm committee chair. On my left, your local trustees, Peter Grove, George Grams, our able minute taker, Mary Hughes, here, and our planning manager, Leah Hartley, to my right. I want to recognize from the traditional territory of the Salish people and recognize their historic stewardship and ask whether anybody's got any items to add. Madam Planner, you have got a brief list for us here.
We have circulated a package today and we wonder if we might add one new item, which would go under 4.6, which are the draft minutes of the Advisory Planning Commission of March 8th, 2012. As well, there are two additions to items that are currently in the package. Item 11.1, the TUP, there is additional information coming out of that same APC meeting. And planner report supplemental recommendations included there. And with item 11.6, there is additions to the staff report dealing with Park Drive. One piece of correspondence from the applicant dated March 9th, 2012.
Is there any objection to amending the agenda to include those items?
Nope.
Not at all, and I have a matter. I don't see on our agenda a discussion about the town halls, and I would like to spend a couple of minutes on that and the plans or possible plans.
Do you want to do that under upcoming meetings?
Certainly, which is where?
That's number 15. So 15.2 could be town hall.
Community engagement is also included in the work program evaluation. So there's a possibility.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do it under community engagement, yes.
And, all right, so we'll look to you to take some extra time when we discuss the work program, and we won't update the agenda.
Thank you.
To do that. Okay,
and I would like to make an observation, is that the clock is not being changed. So if you're going by that clock,
you may have
a problem.
It says, I'm self-sufficient in
the
clock.
Too, so it's now being corrected as we speak. So that's good.
Thank you for
it's exactly 8:34. So I think you're right.
Are there any other...
It
is 9:30. It's Thursday. We are adopting the agenda unless there are any further additions. The consent to adopt the agenda as amended?
Yes.
Thank you. And time estimates you are fine with, I'm trusting, and you'll ask for more time if we need.
Yes.
We are then moving to item 3.1, page 1 of the agenda, and I'll turn us over to Planning Manager Leah Hartley to introduce the work program report and what you'd like us to achieve today.
Okay. Madam Chair, this today it's a very brief report which provides focus on something called the chart or the matrix, which was presented at the last meeting. At the last meeting, we discussed taking a look at many different proposals and evaluating them against some set criteria, being the official community plan or the strategic plan. And today, we're hoping that the LTC is able to spend some time going through that in a rather deliberative fashion, and we can certainly, I've asked the Island Planner and Planner 2 to join us here this morning so that we can engage and dialogue on these. My anticipation is that to establish a full work program upon establishing priorities for the term, staff will come back to the next meeting with a proposal that matches staff resources and timing of different priorities into a full work program. So today is, again, just one step in that process of establishing a work program for the term. We, of course, in January set out four immediate priorities, and staff have been working on those. The first one perhaps comes to an end in a month's time or so, and so I think today, as we, it's timely to try and sort through these and determine that which has a high and medium priority. Perhaps those that are viewed today as having low priority, we might be so brave to say that upon given a low priority, that they maybe fall off the work program and are not considered in terms of staff resources over 3 years. Certainly can keep that information as far as we got and what the potential partners may have been, but proceed no further unless events change. And with that in mind, I'll note that we revisit this work program every 3 months or so, with an attempt to look at how's work going on the immediate priorities. Are we meeting our intended timeframes? Are we meeting our deliverables? Should the scope be enhanced or reduced in order to conclude an initiative well, and then move on to the next priority? So we do routinely revisit these things and allow you to adjust during the term as things change in the community. So with that in mind, what I'm hoping to do is to use the PowerPoint as a bit of a flip chart and capture some of the dialogue that trustees have on these items. You'll recall that 3 weeks ago, there was agreement on the matrix providing a good foundation for discussion. It was provided electronically to trustees to think about, to record their own notes. Back in January, there was a more full description of each of these work program items, and the numbers in your matrix match the numbers on this, so I can hand this out if it's helpful to anyone or if you have questions. If that works for people, I'm wondering if we might be able to sort of deal with this like a flip chart, and maybe also invite the other planners to come closer, more of a round table discussion, although they're pretty close as well. But I'll just I'll talk a little bit about this chart. Here's this first page are the top four priorities as currently established, so I filled out the chart with them. The OCP review on RAR, of course, comes out of OCP policies. It's an ongoing and recent initiative. It's given a nod in the Islands Trust Strategic Plan. It has some legal requirements behind it, so it gets checks in those four columns. Scope or significance, it obviously is draws a lot of resources, both staff resources and budgetary resources. And it has been given a top priority, so work is now going on that. So LUB secondary suites continues to be a top priority as well. Video recording pilot and evaluation is something that's ongoing. It doesn't come out of any OCP policies or strategic plan, but certainly represented significance to the community. So in January, that was put on the top priority list, and we've been engaged in a pilot program through the February and today's meetings. In April, we'll have a report on findings from this pilot program, at which point in time a decision will need to be made as to whether where the trustees want to go with this, if it wants to make it a routine part of its LTC, engage the community through other forums. That can be a decision we make in April once we have the findings from the pilot. Advisory committee's review terms of reference also is a top priority. So then we come to number five on this chart, which is the beginning of what then becomes some 20 rows. OCP review phase two, the shoreline DP areas, that's one shown as number five on your chart, which has some backing in the OCP policies, has some ongoing or recent work done by Islands Trust through the local planning committee, has some relationship to the strategic plan, and has a budget in this this year, not tied to the fiscal, but does have an Islands Trust budget through grants that are available to us this year. So this will be one that we're asking for you to think about for, in terms of a high, medium, or low priority. And I have the same row on the next page, so maybe I'll flip to the next page. And you'll see that same row repeated here. And now, over the last 3 weeks, trustees were working with the matrix and have passed on comments or questions to me, and I've tried to just capture some of the questions as they come up with each of these items. So not many questions on this page, but you'll see on the next page that quite a bit has already been posed as questions from individual trustees. So I can flip between these two pages. One of the very first questions, and this has been common to several of the initiatives, a question of new trustees asking if Salt Spring staff and Salt Spring Local Trust Committee resources have been allocated to the initiative, or if the resources shown in this column three are those that are reflective of Islands Trust, either another region or Islands Trust generally. So that has been a common question of several of these.
So do you want to answer these questions now, or are you proposing?
I think we can perhaps go through, and as that becomes a question with each one, we can answer that. How does that sound? Or if you want, I can go through and let you know that if that helps sort this list and refine it a little bit.
Where were you thinking of going next? If we didn't.
I was thinking maybe a row by row kind of commentary, and then going back through them and asking on the basis of commentary questions, sense of the whole thing, high, medium, or low. How does that sound?
Mm-hmm. How would you like to work through this, trustees? Do you want to go through and make sure we've all are on the same page so far as the technical information and questions, and then go back and?
That's probably makes good sense, but over, as an overall plan, I mean, the reality is we can only deal with so many
yes.
programs, right?
Yes.
So I mean, I think if we can identify what we think are the essential ones, everything then becomes everything else has to be put on hold. So I wasn't comfortable with a point you made earlier, which is maybe we can get rid of some of these programs if they are going to be very low priority. I mean, everything on this list, I assume, has been put together by thoughtful people in the past, feeling that they were useful, worthwhile programs. So I'd actually hate to lose sight of them. Trying to sort things out, obviously what we're doing right now, the top priority, and then would be our next tier in order of priority as to what as we knock these off, as how we bring them up. So I guess if you want to call that medium priority, that would be fine. And then the rest would be low. And it's not that we don't value them as useful projects. It's just the reality is there's only so much time and energy and effort that people can put into them.
I think the with respect to the low, some of these items were put on the work program at start of last term, expecting that we might be able to accomplish 30 projects during the course of a 3-year term.
Right.
I think as the term progressed, we realized that was far too ambitious.
Right.
If they remain on the work program, it's a 3-year term work program, so some members of the community may have some anticipation that even if indicated as low, that there's some expectation that we would be looking to partner with members of the community on that sort of thing over the course of 3 years. So we can discuss that of what's the expectation of these. The official community plan and the strategic plan, of course, give you a 20-year direction and has many items which sooner or later you will want to turn your attention to. I think that this that you have right now, you've inherited from the previous term of office. It was an ambitious work program, and I think that certainly we will focus on the high and the medium, and we can decide after going through this exercise really what we want to do in terms of expectations.
Okay.
If I could, I'll maybe add something to your comment, Trustee Grove. The other trust committees and committees of trust council have a work program, and then they have a project list. And there's no expectation that the project list is going to get carried out at any particular point in time, and it wouldn't be plugged into a timeline with any kind of dates or anything associated with it. So there is a mechanism for that. We don't have that on this agenda, but other trust committees do.
Yeah.
So it is very much the catch-all that identifies. The trust committee knows that they're either the community or trustees or staff have identified that work needs to be done. It's not going to happen in the near term at all. So I would certainly encourage you, if there's things that you agree are not something that you think can necessarily be achieved in your term of office, but nevertheless you want to hang on to them to trigger that, that the work at some point is going to be necessary, I would suggest that you flag them as such, and there is a tool to be able to at least keep them in a list, even if not cluttering up your staff priorities for this term.
That makes sense to me. What do you think?
I think from that point of view it would be helpful to run through these.
Yeah, good.
I certainly have ones I believe are fairly high in priority. The low and mediums we can sort later, but I think there are specific ones we have to identify for action.
Can I suggest that we move through them one number at a time, make sure that we have our questions answered about each, and if either of the trustees at that point wants to indicate you're thinking high, medium, low, that allows us to sort of hear each other as we go, and then we can, at the end, run through it one more time and make some decisions. Is that all right?
I, at the risk of repeating myself, though, I do want to emphasize that if Trustee Grams and I say low to something, it doesn't mean that we don't value it.
Yeah.
We think, we look at this schedule, I can see they're all valuable programs, but we do have a reality of what we can achieve.
Agreed. Like, that's clear, and that's a good clarification.
Sure.
So does anybody have questions about the top two? I think we're quite familiar with RAR and secondary suites.
Well, you mean 6 and 7?
I've got 1 and 2 on my
list. Oh, sorry. We know. I thought we were now on to...
Okay, so do you want to move right to the...
to number 5.
To number 5.
Yes.
So there was a question on this one. Is that the one about resources? No. Shoreline review. Anybody have questions on that?
Well, I don't really know what it means, a shoreline review, but I expect it's one of those things. But yes, please.
So this is a planner, Sarah Mack, planner 2.
Indeed. As far as I understand the shoreline review, I do know we Salt Spring Island itself had a shoreline study done in the 1980s, basically categorized the shorelines into kind of two, let's say, it told us what medium it was going around, whether it's callable, etc. And that was supposed to be updated for all the islands, just recently, last couple of years. I'm not entirely sure in the program. I know when I jumped into it, I got involved in, there's a shoreline mapping project, which was in conjunction with the Green Shores project to encourage green development along shorelines, and as well as it was tied into the UBC mapping of slopes for the riparian area, so it was kind of all happening at the same time. So when I got involved, it was going forward that the shorelines were to be mapped, and actually, zoom to today, we do have an updated mapping of it. And what the shoreline has mapped is once again the shoreline material itself, but it's also mapped the risks and the direction of energy. So whichever way the wave action is coming, and then match it to whatever type of material it is. Obviously some structures are stronger than others, and so where, and then furthermore, where does that siltation go? So it gives us a much better understanding of the risk and the energy transfer of materials. So that is currently up available on our websites. We have that information done. I think part of the vision was, well, then how do you use that information? And part of the environmental development permit review process in the last term of office was to take take that information, update our, we do have a development permit area 3 shoreline, and to take that information, update that permit area with the better information, and then update things and complete things. So there are other side projects they were talking about which haven't been done yet, and that's, you know, it highlights the risk, but they're also trying to look at it from a different perspective and trying to see what are the attached values to the shoreline. And you know, I love that idea personally. I'll give you an example, maybe I should say riparian areas, but see streams adding, you know, certain nutrients to waterways which feed into, say, herring that are running in March, and then the herring into, you know, eelgrass at the mouth there, which is shown in the shoreline. And of course, and how that feeds up the food chain all the way to say the value, which is really highly identified to say orcas. People really value having orcas in that area. So my point is we can tie the shoreline into values that people have of the Gulf Islands. So.
People have questions in the
floor. It's useful to have the maps. I think some sort of profile or overall appreciation of the natural erosion risks is, I could see, really useful. Where I have a gap in my knowledge is how we tie that into what kind of protective measures we need, and also how that would be built into the bylaw. I wonder if there's a sort of, I need help there in the way of perhaps further education of some sort. And I wonder if there's something we can do in Victoria that might help fill in our gaps of knowledge there, or even get a briefing on island as to how we line up the ducks. Because I'm not sure.
I'll give you one example of how it's been put in place. And we have, in our zoning, we have shoreline conservation areas. An example is at Fulford, you see the sort of delta, and that is a shoreline conservation area, as well as Booth Canal. And that was identified from knowing the shorelines and materials. So just one example of how it's used. Mm-hmm.
But we have the maps in place now.
We do, but they're just information. They haven't been, right. They haven't been used, per se. Mm-hmm.
So can we put a question next to that? Is that what we should do?
Unless anybody's got an instinct or a proposal now, then yes.
There's nothing urgently that needs addressed at this moment in time. We're not in a firefighting situation where, unless we make a decision, okay. And in that case, I think the question mark's probably the right idea. And if I can discuss with staff how I can be further educated in this, it would be helpful.
If I can add one more thing, Miles has, you know, what on his radar, he had the hardening, so to speak, of the shoreline areas, and one of them, obviously living up on islands. A lot of people want their water access, and so that is, I wouldn't say, I mean, that's, I think, why it's somewhat high on that area, there is and recognition of that as something better too.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. I've got a couple of suggestions on this one. One is that other trust committees are already going ahead in this area. Theta spent a lot of time last term, pulled back at the last minute, so didn't include it in their OCP. They had a higher level of help from the UBC contract than the rest of the trust committees did. I think because it's a smaller island, they were able to focus a little bit deeper. Galliano did adopt a shoreline development permit area in the previous term, but Thetis right now is going to be fleshing out the mechanics of how that might work. So if this doesn't, in your hearts, feel like a top priority, it may well be that towards the end of the term or even the next trust committee can be informed by the work that has been done so far as implementing development permit regulations. However, I do think there's a good opportunity now at a stewardship education level to work with your community to at least bring the level of knowledge, because I think we're all in the same situation that Trustee Grams is articulating. It hasn't been clear, politically anyway, what are the impacts of how property owners on the ocean manage their shorelines. So we will have an opportunity to have the UBC team come and present to your community about their findings. And so it might be that your foundation is simply a education and conversation as opposed to regulation.
That would be very helpful.
Yeah, that makes good sense. Mm-hmm.
So if that does resonate with you, then this could end up being a work program item that is tagged as stewardship education only and to be clear that for now it's not going on the path of regulatory action. It's also going to be a multi-year program that we do have funding from some of these external grants, so I think the opportunity to build on the information will continue.
Yep.
Good.
Shall we move to the next one?
Yep.
So this is sensitive ecosystem management, and this is one of the ones that there were questions about.
I've taken that question off now. This one maybe has quite a bit of similarity with the last one. Mapping was done with the province and Environment Canada, I believe, across Islands Trust. It's sensitive ecosystem management mapping has its own methodology and is really looking for biophysical attributes across the land. That mapping was completed about 3 years ago through auspices of Trust Fund Board. It is available and is now online, available to members of the public off of MapIt. 3 years ago, Salt Spring Local Planning Services assisted Trust Fund staff by vetting the draft maps through the, I think, two of our advisory committees, Environmental Advisory Committee and I believe APC, and taking those recommendations and questions back to Trust Fund staff. We then assisted in sponsoring two public information meetings, one in Fulford, one in Ganges, that were well attended and well received about 3 years ago. Since then, I'm not aware of any local planning services resources dedicated to this in the last 3 years. I'll note, though, that the template LTC report has a place for sensitive ecosystem information to be made available, so staff are typically, when opening a file, taking note of if there are sensitive ecosystems, and if they are, then these are brought to attention of the local trust committee. One of the ones that stands out in mind is a Channel Ridge rezoning application, which Stefan was working on a year and a half ago, in which it was flagged that there was a sensitive ecosystem on Channel Ridge, and through his work with the applicant, a decision was made to rezone, allowing density of three lots being moved from one location, which hadn't yet been built and was a sensitive ecosystem, to another location which extended a neighborhood that was currently under development. So we are using these by virtue of the fact the OCP draws attention to sensitive ecosystems, and they're part of our local trust committee reports.
Any questions?
No, I don't think so.
So does that mean that this should be low priority because it's already in place and there's no particular...
I think it was put on with an expectation that staff might take a look at management options, and if additional management options would have merit. We never did, I think we started drafting that report, but never did present it to our local trust committee.
So is the suggestion that the updated mapping would then inform creation of different development permit area boundaries, or what would be the...
That is one option. Right. It also, I should note, has further informed trust fund analysis and has furthered their work. But that's through the regional conservation plan rather than anything that you have responsibility for.
So we already have development permit areas to protect sensitive ecosystems. Is there any...
We have development permits to protect riparian water courses.
All right, so density sending and receiving areas is more what I was thinking of.
Yes.
If the policy is well enough developed to be of a functional use at the current time, I would suggest it could be a low priority. Because it's operating. And I assume if staff didn't feel a pressing need to bring it before the local trust committee, then it indicates a fairly low priority on your behalf too.
Any instincts, Trustee Brogan?
No, just wondering if we, Leo will respond to George. You're suggesting it's a low priority from from staff point of view. You're suggesting it's a low, from a staff point of view, it's a low priority.
I don't think we have heard from the community much indicating of a higher priority.
Yeah.
We're asking about staff, so I'm going to ask our planner, Stark.
Just that it should be understood that where the local trust committee has discretion to make a decision and use that information provided by the sensitive ecosystem mapping, then the local trust committee can use that information and make a good decision, like in the example of the rezoning on Channel Ridge. Mm-hmm. Where the local trust committee doesn't have discretion, that information cannot be used in order to protect the sensitive ecosystem that might be in place. So the example is subdivision, and that's where a lot of destruction of the natural environment happens, and we have, without having implemented the sensitive ecosystem mapping into our bylaw or OCP, we have no ability to protect those sensitive ecosystems. So that's where I think the priority, like the
okay.
The urgency would be felt.
So it's a sense from staff that we could definitely bump it up with work to implement the new mapping into the land use bylaw and OCP.
That was, I think, the
yeah.
intent of
the mapping. Yeah. So elevate this to medium priority. And on the assumption that the top priorities are all high and everything else has to be medium or low.
Yeah. Is that a yes?
That's up
that's
to
a
you.
Judgment.
I was just
going to
explain where.
Okay. Ed?
Number seven, watershed management. Anybody got questions on that one?
Well, that's a huge topic.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're talking about RAR, that's part of watershed management. What else had we in mind here?
So you might be served by looking at the table seven of this
right.
big handout right. that we've got, because it does have the detail yeah. on what's been done. And this is from one of our previous
right.
agenda packages. So, and this is separated from RAR in this situation as a work program.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So RAR and watershed management are two different items.
And Justine, do you want to speak to this one?
Sure.
You've been our liaison with Water Council.
Sure. So the watershed management is something broader than the riparian areas regulation.
Right.
We heard strongly from the community last spring that people would really appreciate having a distinction drawn between implementation of specifically the riparian areas regulation and broader objectives with relation to watershed management. So this watershed management would be the type of policy work that would look to implementing the watershed management plans for the drinking water lakes, St. Mary's and Christian Lake, and look towards things like considering how to improve water quality of the drinking water lakes.
Good.
Okay. So that's, you know, because the water quality issues seem to be becoming more frequent, I would say that that's where this would address.
So that would include such matters as septic fields and tanks?
It could. It would initially involve an analysis of
yeah.
how to improve the runoff into the lakes through land use management.
Right.
So septic is one consideration.
Mm. My feeling is this is high priority.
Absolutely.
One other reason is, for example, we're considering legalization of secondary suites, and if at some future time, as part of the incremental legalization, we do consider secondary suites in some of the watershed areas, we need to have a policy framed, I think, under watershed management to offer some control of that. So certainly high in my list.
And I would add it on my list also, very much so.
All right, can we move on then to eight, which is hazard lands, steep slope, protecting development from the environment.
That sounds strange, doesn't it?
Geotechnical hazards.
So people's homes once built do not slip to the bottom of the hill.
And when you put it that way, it's obvious it should have a very high priority, but I'm back to where we are. There's only so much we can tackle.
Well, on the other hand, it is policed by CRD, and they do ask for geotechnicals and adequate assurances. Yeah. I think it's low on our list of priorities, actually. Right.
But a good point about CRD.
And the trust does have development permit areas in place already to, albeit with older maps. Right. Mm-hmm. So that sounds like a low on both sides.
Yes, please.
Number nine, heritage conservation issues in the official community plan. Any questions about what's contemplated here from the trustees?
It's not on my radar particularly. I'm not sure. I mean, I know that some individuals in the community, I think with particular others, Jonathan Yardley, I think, has taken some initiative in this, and credit to him for doing so. I don't know where we are in that, or it doesn't seem that there's an urgent need to protect any buildings that are immediately in peril. I think there are other priorities other than this one.
Any staff comments on that?
We've really done very little work over the last 3 years on this, and I'm not aware of us having any knowledge other than what you've expressed. It's
Okay, low priority.
Yes, it is. It I hate to put things at low priority because it makes it seem that we're not interested, and but we have to choose.
Yeah, that's the thing. And as long as it's clear that if a particular building is in peril, that doesn't give us time to put a bylaw in place. So we just have to know that there could be some unintended consequences from that. But I hear what you're saying. Move to number 10, raptor nest manager.
Sorry.
I was just going to add, just for information, I'm not sure if you're aware that we do have a heritage permit area. I mean, certain buildings are connected already.
Good, good.
Just so you know that there is a mechanism.
That's comforting.
Good.
Well done.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Raptor nest management, number 10. Any questions on this one?
So this would require identifying the nests and then controlling what's happening in that vicinity, right?
Justine?
I'm sorry, I was just turning my phone off so that doesn't happen again. So, as outlined here, the raptor nests only have protection in the land use bylaw. In the subdivision section where people are required to provide a biologist report to identify if there's a raptor nest in the vicinity, and if there is, there's management practices that should be followed in order to protect these raptor nests. I fielded a call recently from the Conservancy, and they were quite concerned about a specific raptor nest and were wondering what tools you might have to ensure its protection, and I had to admit we really had very little. That's where this policy area needs work, is to consider how we might be able to, what tools could be used to further protect raptor nests.
Okay.
So on Gabriola, there is a land use bylaw regulation that says you cannot build or disturb within this distance. So we've got models in other places, and we're not unique. So if this resonated at all, I don't want to downplay the amount of work involved, but the mapping is done, as I understand it, through the Conservation Data Center or Wildlife Tree Stewardship. So if you've got any curiosity in this, it might be worth getting an assessment as to how much work might be involved, because it may be almost look like a housekeeping item just by inserting some text.
Yeah.
I think that's a good idea.
Mm.
Yeah.
Do you want to call it medium for
now? Sure. Can I ask what raptor encompasses? Mm. Is it just birds of prey?
Can you answer that?
Yeah, it's osprey. It's what's protected. It's that identified by two species at risk of that. That includes osprey, bald eagles, and others. I'm not entirely sure, but it also includes blue herons.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's what's been identified under the species at risk.
Okay.
So
but it's not ravens or crows or...
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. Probably better called carrion.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
What's that? Includes pterodactyls, no doubt.
Number 11, climate change adaptation update. Anybody have questions on what is contemplated here?
Emission targets. This is something that's been in the on the site for a while. Is this, and this is where that would fall, I take it. Emission targets.
The targets are set. I think that the description here is more how then might you amend your bylaws to help achieve those emission targets. Is there any staff advice on this one, just to flesh that out a little bit more?
This is one that's actually received minimal work from in office staff. It was really an initiative that was spearheaded by the community, and Brody Porter was the staff person who worked with the community on this. So I don't have personal experience with it, but there may be also in land use planning there. You know, like there's definitely a short list of things that we can do with a land use bylaw to achieve these emission reduction targets. But, you know, it's very much a collaborative effort that needs to take happen through the community as a whole. The OCP does have the targets set out in it, so there might be, you know, an analysis needs to be done as to what the land use bylaw can do to further the, you know, achievement of those goals.
So it could be things like redesigning subdivision layout requirements to require greater clustering. It could be looking at requirements in your village area to make the place more walkable. You could, in your DP, require a plug-in place for electric vehicles. I mean, there's sort of things like that that it's more, the trust has limited tools to, can we exhaust those tools before leaning on other agencies to carry out their responsibilities?
I don't know how proactive we're being in the advocacy role, but it seems to me we should be going after the big ticket items when it comes to greenhouse gas emissions. And they are building insulation values, which is a provincial issue, or indeed a federal one. And we should be looking for changes to the BC building code. We could dramatically increase the energy efficiency of our buildings and impact that way with the provincial government introducing one piece of legislation as opposed to lots of little communities trying to do it on a kind of piecemeal measure. And the other way is transport, of course, and I think if we can take the measures that you rightly identified on Gabriola, where we can facilitate the use of low-speed electrical vehicles in Salt Spring, then I think that would help too. That's two immediate measures, it would seem, that we could do. Lobby the provincial government, and I would like to see that as a trust initiative, not just a local
right.
trust committee, and put in place the measures that the Gabriola Local Trust Committee sensibly did on their own community with regard to electrical vehicles. So I'd place this as medium.
I would, yeah.
So medium, and I'm just putting the note that it sounds like more of an advocacy focus than necessarily a land use bylaw redesign. Mm-hmm. I realize actually that this is adaptation, not mitigation. So some of the things that might be included in there from a land use bylaw point of view might be setbacks from the ocean. What could we require so far as building siting that makes new construction more resilient in the face of increased storms? I thought the planner's got some ideas here.
Yeah, I mean, there are maps available on hypothetical situations at sea rise levels, and then thinking specifically in Ganges. And when you see those maps, there's significant impact projected to happen in Ganges itself. And if you take the old infrastructure of fill, I think the bar hall is a fantastic example of if that gets demolished or replaced, they're going to have to deal with projected sea rise over the next 100 years. So what type of development is that going to be? Do we rely on developers to take that initiative, or do we put that in, say, development permit area one, say, any future developments must take into consideration, say, a few meter rise or whatever it is projected. So there are maps available, and I think that could be a possible mechanism for those target areas. Mm-hmm.
So if village planning ends up being a priority, then that may be a way to get in there.
Right.
Great,
nice. Good point.
We could look at having submersible buildings.
Yeah. Or building like the New Richmond with a keel.
Yes.
Work for life. That's good for a planner's point of view. Okay, number 12, village planning. Anybody have questions or comments on that one?
Well, village planning is certainly something we've been talking about. How, at this point, we want to talk about it tying into OCP and LUB, I'm not sure. Certainly, we want to be looking at village planning as an overall.
On the basis that none of the ones we're dealing with is high priority, this is medium.
That's okay with me, yeah.
And that would be a big piece of work, my sense.
Yes.
Yeah. I might report that we've had very favourable response from School of Architecture in partnering with the local community and trying to construct a process for, or designing a process for community engagement and for how we go about facilitating regeneration of our villages and the next stage in that is for a visit that I will make to the School of Architecture to see if we can consolidate any of the thoughts on that with the head of the school, and I'll report back on that in due course. I'm hoping we can get something up this summer or autumn, probably autumn, because the accommodation will be easier.
Great. And number 13, Bill 27, which is the greenhouse gas emission reduction targets for Piers Island. Any questions on this one?
This is a bit of work that is required by provincial legislation. We inadvertently did not attend to setting greenhouse emission targets for Piers Island when we were doing so for Salt Spring Island. There's an approach that has been applied by Islands Trust on other similar islands, which is to put a placekeeping holder in the OCP with respect to targets being set at time of any development proposals on the islands. So if you wanted work done on this, it would be seen to be probably a housekeeping amendment to the Piers Island OCP.
And how much time does a housekeeping amendment take?
By the fact that it requires a public hearing and several bylaws, and then travel at least on one occasion to the affected island, that's the bulk of the time. However, if we applied the same protocol as other similar islands, then it's limited type of resources other than to take it through the necessary bylaw process.
And is this a provincial requirement?
It is a provincial
requirement. So we need to do it, yes. I guess, medium.
Yeah. I think it wouldn't be time-consuming. There are models from other associated islands, and it's the only OCP in the trust area that hasn't been done, so it would be nice to say that we've completed our requirement.
Good point.
Land use bylaw update number 14 on cottages. Anybody have questions on this one?
Well, we're putting a lot of energy and effort into suites, and the recommendation has been that we leave cottages alone for the time being. So I would put it at medium.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Number 15, land use bylaw update, remaining industrial task force recommendations. Questions on this one?
This is definitely high.
Absolutely, without no question about that.
No further discussion needed? 16, land use bylaw update on affordable housing. Any questions?
Justine, maybe should.
I'll invite Island Planner Stark to flesh this out a little bit, if you would.
So, secondary suites is a very small part of the whole umbrella affordable housing policy work that really had a lot of momentum in the last term. And in fact, there's remaining work items on my follow-up action list to bring reports to the local trust committee to further that. And it, basically, in summary, the kinds of things, I think that there's a lot that the land use bylaw could do to enable affordable housing to happen more easily and inexpensively. And so there's been some work done in this, and further analysis is required. But so, for example, using the idea that was put forward in a staff report is to use density bonusing and other provisions that other communities use to so that affordable housing advocates don't have to make an application to rezone every time they get a project together, because that is very difficult when you're getting funding from different agencies to also sympathize them through a rezoning process. So that's kind of where that comes from, is an analysis of how the land use bylaw could enable the creation of affordable housing.
Sounds like you think it's a good idea.
It's a project that I've been working on, so I'm more invested in it than I am some of these other items.
Mm-hmm. But I think that's something we need to do. I'd put it on a higher.
Since Peter and I took office, there have been some pleasing initiatives on the affordable housing front, there is some promise that a number of developments will come forward. They haven't been formally lodged yet, but certainly we've taken part in a couple of discussions, and we've referred certain applicants to planning staff as well. So it looks promising. But medium for this one.
Sorry, we're putting...
Or is it high?
High, I thought
high,
we said.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
We may have to readjust.
Yes, you need to prioritize your
the highs
priorities.
And the lows. Somebody could very kindly turn the heat switch on. That would be the timer. That would be very kind. Thank you.
Number 17, farmworker housing. Anybody have questions on the mechanics of this one?
Well,
Justine, would you like to comment on this too? Because I think you've been working on this as well.
Yeah, good.
A briefing would be helpful.
This was another one that had focused during the last term. Oh, I'm sorry. It had focused during the last term, and just frankly, they had such a full plate that it didn't get advanced to the point that was expected. You were issued a copy of a letter to the George Ehring during the last term, right at the end of the last term, which is specific to an application but has a little sentence about the Land Commission would be interested in meeting with the local trust committee to discuss farmworker housing. And so that is opens the door a little bit wider. What the provisions in the Land Commission Act allow for is for local governments to allow farmworker housing without application to the Land Commission if the local government is confident that it's needed for farmworker housing. So there would need to be a local application process, I would expect, but that there is room in the legislation for the local trust committee to take more autonomy over the decision on farmworker housing. So that's where this project comes from. So looking at ways to amend the land use bylaw within provincial regulations to bring more autonomy locally to the decision on farmworker housing. And then there's criteria in the legislation for how to do that. And there's examples from other communities. There was a staff report written March 29th, 2010. It's a 24-page report, and it goes into this in some detail.
My own view is that having an early discussion with the Agricultural Land Commission to try and advance that would be really beneficial.
Yes.
So, medium to high.
Well, I'd put it on high, since we don't have a medium to high.
Right.
But it also, I don't think that should take up a lot of time, should it, staff time?
I think it actually is quite a heavy project, because it will require a consultation with the community, and basically the criteria that the local trust committee comes up with in order to evaluate whether somebody has a legitimate need for farmworker housing, that's where the deliberations with the community and with the Land Commission will basically take some time.
Mm-hmm. Well,
there's more to it than, because you need to establish how to determine whether people have a legitimate need for farm worker housing. And as a local government, if you have any question, you need to refer that to the Land Commission for the decision. So you have to be able to have a process here that gives you certainty.
Okay, I would like to think that we could make it more simple than that. Maybe I'm naive. Okay, but let's have it on the high list, and we can work on that.
Number 18, land use bylaw technical updates. Anybody have questions on the mechanics of this one?
Well, this is basically, as we were talking about some time back, about simplifying the zoning. Basically, is that not right? Yeah.
That is one message that we have heard by the community, and we've heard two messages, one from the community saying simplify the zoning, one from staff saying take a really good look at the wording of individual regulations and try and create some greater understanding or consistency in interpretation of the regulations.
This is high priority.
Yes, absolutely.
355 is a mess.
Yeah, it is. So we're doing a good job of creating high priority items here.
And one of our things could be the advocate for a 6-year term. to carry this all out. Okay, number 19, development approval information bylaw. Anybody have questions on the mechanics of it? We've talked a bit about this before, I think.
I would like some clarification, please.
Can I ask the which planner would like to speak to this?
Do you want me to pick up on it from Mark Broderick? Was our former island planner and did quite a bit of work about 18 months ago or 2 years ago on a DAI bylaw, and that was based on some work that had been done centrally. And there's a template DAI bylaw that Trust Council has endorsed. It all arises from a change in provincial legislation some number of years ago now. That established that there's encourages communities to establish by bylaw its procedures around dealing with applications, and in practical application it would influence tremendously your application of development permit areas and zoning applications in particular. We got as far as identifying as a high priority, setting staff to it, and developing a draft bylaw, which was presented to local trust committee. It went into an in-camera deliberation in order to receive legal advice. And I think that raised questions that the trustees at that point in time wanted to flesh out further before proceeding. So the work really has been put on hold and is there if you wish to pick it up and proceed with it. I would suggest that the discussion about quality management has perhaps raised the profile of this again. It's not necessarily a quality management system, doesn't represent the ISO standards, but certainly has a lot of overlap in terms of creating certainty for applicants with respect to the processing of applications and the requirements attached to applications.
My own experience, the not having a development approval information bylaw means that the trust committee is limited in what it can ask for from applicants, especially in areas like a development permit. So without a DAI to go with your development permits, you may have some limited ability to have them work to their full extent. There's sort of it's a pairing. And a number of islands have a DAI bylaw. North Pender has the most recent one, which is really robust. It's better than the Trust Council model bylaw. It's described as an administrative bylaw. It doesn't generally really take any public input into it because it's just a way to implement your OCP and land use bylaw. So I guess in my mind, two benefits. One is that it gives applicants an idea of what might be reasonably expected of them going through an application process. and it also allows the trust committee to have better confidence around carrying out the community's intentions through the that are expressed in the OCP.
It sounds to me as if it should be considered, if it should run concurrent with our process for putting in place quality management procedures.
Yes.
And that I have that as a high priority. Mm. And if we can develop the approval information bylaw so that it has some place in that procedure, then I think it would be useful.
So are you suggesting that we just move 19 to become part of quality management, which is 25, to reduce the number of things you've got on the list?
I don't know if that's practical. It would certainly be an answer. QM procedures and the approvals that
including
the process as part of the QM the QM process. So why not?
They are two different products. The quality management process would be something that is a procedural, a way that that staff carry out application processing, as opposed to DAI, is a bylaw that is totally in the hands of the trust committee.
Mm.
But they may well be two subsets of them.
Whatever, Leah, what would you like to
say? I think the two do link. I think that you establish a bylaw to create certainty amongst some of the process, and you really, I think there is value in knowing what you're going to do in terms of your process and what you're going to do by bylaw, and having that dialogue together.
So what's your thoughts in terms of merging them into one? Is that practical or not?
If quality management is going to be high priority, then I think this is an important discussion to have in light of quality management. So I would also, if you're going to do QM as high, I would do this one as high as well.
That's my feeling.
Good. Yeah. That's what, yeah. Let's do both. Yeah. Both of the same. We can knock both off, if you like, Madam Chair. Yeah.
So would you bring them together under one heading, are you suggesting?
Perhaps not. If they need to go divergent, that's fine. Okay. But I would, in terms of staff resources, I'd probably put the same planner on it and tailor them at the same time.
Yeah. Right.
What I would like to see into the description under 19, sorry to drag this out, but so that for my own use, so we development approval information bylaw in brackets as part of QM review. Would that be all right?
Sure. They're both high, 19 and 25, both like this high here. Number 20, soil bylaw. Who would like to introduce us to this one?
I think Miles and I are the two most familiar with this one. The soils bylaw came into place about 3.5 years ago and is needing a bit of tweaking in order to be fully in place. The bylaw itself is in place. The fees bylaw has not come into effect, was drafted and run through LTC, but has not been accepted by the province. The reason for the delay in the fees part of it is questions about overlap of the original bylaw with the Mines Act. So that would be a simple housekeeping amendment, and then adoption of the fees part of this. What we've heard from the community through one of the trustees is that if we're opening up and doing a housekeeping amendment to this bylaw, the operators have expressed an interest in a minor change in the operating hours during the winter. So it might be viewed as housekeeping amendments.
I think there's benefit in getting some feedback, since it's been the bylaw is of an age, I think, that we could benefit from some input from those who are affected by it, to see if there are any improvements that we can make. And we could do that at the same time as we look at the fees issue.
How do you rank it? Is that a medium?
I'd say. I think we've got plenty highs in
we
there.
We do, that's right. Yeah, I agree.
Number 21, we're an hour into our conversation.
Low.
We can speed it up.
Speed it up?
Yeah, low.
21 is?
It's low, but in my mind also, only because it's a huge task. It involves so many different layers of, of government and management. I just think it's impractical. So that's why I would give it a low.
Number 22, stormwater management low. Plan. Trustee Grove?
Yeah, no, I would add, I would agree. Again, I think it involves so many different ministries that it's impractical to put it on a high.
And the place isn't flooding. I mean, it's...
Yet.
It was this morning.
Number 23.
Well, I would like to put this on high, and I hear Trustee Graham say the same. This is where I want to... At some stage, we need to do something about our town halls, and we have some thoughts on that, which we can discuss at a later time.
Can we entertain some discussion on that now, just
yes.
so that staff have an idea of what's...
Yes, Trustee Grove.
I speaking just for myself, my vision is to have an open town hall, which would involve dialogue rather than basically the one-way exchange that we have here, and it would be at a more user-friendly time, late afternoon, early evening. It would be held in a sort of circular form rather than in a theater kind of style. It would be chaired by somebody competent and able to chair these meetings. And the way it would be an ongoing conversation with the community. I would see it starting for the first time as one does in any kind of retreat long-range planning meeting. Let's talk about what are the issues that people want to talk about. Let's not talk about them now, but let's identify the issues. And you can identify the issues and then bring, and over time, and this is a ongoing process over the years, we would start to look at those issues and discuss them as a community. So not necessarily addressing particular projects as we do at these meetings, and that should continue. But as I say, a community dialogue, finding out what people want and getting some real valuable discussion going. And that's my view of it.
Well, I'm the same view. I think existing and emerging issues we discuss as a community. We set up this sort of dialogue that we had during the discussion for the policy statement review. Of course, Peter and I took part in that, and if there are issues on that would affect the local trust committee, we can't engage in that way. We could, however, partner with other groups within the community, the Conservancy in some issues, the Water Council with others, maybe the Chamber of Commerce and a third, in their specific fields of expertise for appropriate issues, so that they are the principal enablers of the dialogue at the meeting, and they chair the meeting. We could be there to observe, and the community can participate. And I think that would allow us to gauge community views, community opinion, inform through those processes, so that before we even begin the process of assembling bylaws and regulations, we have a feeling for, firstly, we've undertaken some community educational exercise, and we also have the benefit of the feedback from that.
How any staff advice on how we might proceed with some of these ideas?
Can I just suggest, I think we know what the existing and emergent issues are. I think we have to look to who we might partner with on those, what kind of forums would be appropriate, where we hold them. We have one coming up, for example, on the or two for secondary suites, the community information meeting. It's others we can certainly look at a program for. We can see who in the community can help. That does two things. It engages the community through some of the organizations in it, and it reduces the weight of preparation and organization that's incumbent on staff and trustees. So perhaps collectively we can prepare, our priority list here emerges, we can look at what a program of town hall meetings might comprise, and who we involve as partners in that program.
Can I look to the planning manager for any advice on what sort of direction the trust committee would need to give, or what the next step might be?
I think this is one where I know the planning team said to me, get from them exactly what it is that they're looking for. And one of the key questions was, we do have a budget identified this year for community engagement pilot. Was it the intent that this budget be addressed to a specific kind of idea pilot, which it sounds from the discussion, that's what I'm picking up, is that we should really think about a program of town halls, starting out with identifying the issues and then how to work with the community and with other agencies towards addressing those issues. So I think with that, it might be something like others that as a high priority, you would expect us to work on a scope of work, a proposal, and a time frame for getting it underway. And so I would expect that would be something for us to put our minds to and come back to you with a proposal.
Good. First class.
Good, yeah. Thank you.
So are you happy just with this conversation? You don't need any kind of a written proposal from either of the trustees. We can just take your advice at large.
I think on any one
I'll
of these
follow
we need
up
the scope. Yeah.
With some written suggestions. It's always useful to have a written framework.
Okay, great. And that could even be on our next agenda so that there's some transparency
mm-hmm.
around.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Justine, any other questions, though? Let me just...
Yeah. No, I think it's a great idea, and my mind was always already kind of going how we could do that without it having each one be a special meeting with the LTC. So, mm-hmm. You know, I have some ideas.
Good.
Too,
good.
So
good.
And having something in writing, I think, is especially helpful as well, that staff can check with the legislative services manager around, let's make sure that we're not going to get into quorum problems, or how can we work with that and not against it. So,
question. It seems to me, if I heard correctly, that the revamping of the website is proposed to include something like Dr. Borzulis's idea mm-hmm. about a bank, an ideas bank. Mm-hmm. And that sounds a lot, you know, so they're basically somewhere where ideas can germinate and take on the
yes.
UDD input without, you know, interference, so to speak. So just thinking about this idea, it sounds like those two are very much harmonized at the same time. So
good.
If we're mm-hmm. going to do a community engagement, that's obviously a part of it in my mind. And mm-hmm. harmonizing those two together would be very well.
Good.
Yep.
Good point.
Okay, good ideas. Thank you. Number 24, bylaw enforcement programs. I realize I'm not really clear on how this would be a trust committee project.
I think we've put this on as our consistent reminder that if LTC is working with bylaw enforcement on a overall policy, then that might always be your fifth priority, that we don't get into undertaking a community-wide enforcement initiative or two at the same time as taking on five planning work programs that right. in the past has overwhelmed the resources within the Salt Spring region. So I think that this, for instance, right now we know that bylaw enforcement's turning its attention to the secondary suites, which probably means that other things have fallen lower than in bylaw enforcement resources, and then there's the STBR, where we heard previously that there'd be work done in April to close some of the STBR files. So those are things that we always want to keep track of in terms of the LTC work program.
Can I ask the bylaw enforcement coordinator, Miles Drew, just to talk a little bit about the how your work program gets managed and whether we need to have your work program on the trust committees?
Well, there's not really a clear way yet to manage bylaw enforcement programs, but what's evolved or evolving is that the executive oversees it, is in control of the resources for it, really. But what we've experienced is that we start an initiative, the LTC on salt springs says, yes, do a proactive program on SDBRs, it invariably has an impact on the planning staff. Inquiries come flooding in, for what people to do to escape enforcement, et cetera. So that's why that's on there, is because if we're doing something that's likely to cause a lot of overflow all at once into the planning sphere, it's necessary to know about it in terms of consumption planning resources.
Right.
And that SDR program isn't finished, or as I said before, we're waiting for a result from West Specifications legal action. And if it comes in positive, they start to create another wave of planning.
So this number 24 is ongoing, really.
It's
ongoing. So I'm not sure. Our chair wondered if it should be on the list at all. It's just something that has to be done.
Yeah. I guess my sense is that because there are all kinds of other things that can interfere with your with the trust committee's work program getting achieved in the way that it wants. Maybe you have a very high-profile affordable housing application that you acknowledge you want it to get processed before some of your other proactive policy things. So I guess my sense is rather than having this on the work program, that the trust committee will just acknowledge that if it does ask for some kind of bylaw enforcement program in a particular area, we have to be warned that it will have impacts, but it's not something that we're not proposing to redesign.
Can we remove it then from the list?
Or do we just say ongoing? Do we have an ongoing category?
We could, but I think that at that point your community is going to say to you, what bylaw enforcement do you have planned for us?
I agree.
And
So take it off?
To me it's a reality, but I don't think it fits with the others myself.
Okay.
Hey, we deleted one. Great. And quality management procedures we've already got as high.
Yes.
Are there other items that the trustees have identified that they want to have on this list for consideration? Trustee Grove.
Yes, you'll be hearing, as we have heard a number of occasions from Dr. Tom Vassiliotis, of a particular concern he had. He has some ALR land, about 35 acres, and some time back he attempted to create a small subdivision for a house for his daughter, which he believes falls fairly and squarely under the section 946 of the Local Government Act, which kind of flies in the face of the OCP policy B62213. I've discussed this with staff, and it was felt that this would be a worthwhile exercise to review this and to get an understanding of just where we are on it. We need more information. How is it considered to be inconsistent is precise wording I wish to use.
So the suggestion is to review that section of the official community plan?
Yes, and to understand better why it is considered inconsistent with section 946 of the Local Government Act.
Could you repeat the OCP policy?
OCP policy is B62213, and the Local Government Act is section 946.
At the time that Dr. Varzaliotis' application was on the table, the Trust Committee offered to review that section and to set his application aside while we did that, and he didn't want us to do that. But I guess this is maybe a new... That was several years ago.
Yeah, this is actually not responding necessarily to him. It's just an issue with... I understand, I have been told by staff, there is significant confusion in this area, and it could do with sorting out.
How do you want to describe this on the work program list? Subdivision for a relative policy?
No, I'd say review of B62213 vis-a-vis section 946 of the Local Government Act.
That's not going to be meaningful to your constituents, so I wonder if there's a couple of phrases that you could use
describe it. Could we wrap it up with the land use bylaw examination and possible revision so that we include this legislation under that same exercise.
Which number is that?
Well, we were going to look at 355.
Yeah.
Whatever that one is. It's not 15.
18.
That's the one.
Under 18.
Under 18.
I would suggest it either could wrap into the LUB update, although it is an OCP, where okay. I see some familiar or some similarity. Again, it's an LUB update, but you'll be looking to work with the Land Commission on farm worker housing. And it seems to me that if you wanted to parallel discussion with the Land Commission at that same time on wording of the OCP policies, you might be able to handle the two at the same time. So keep it as a separate item, but do at the same time as LUB update on farm worker housing.
Okay.
My concern about doing this is I don't want it just to go into, I mean, I like it this addressed soon,
okay.
Because we have a couple of pressing issues. I mean, I'm happy to make a motion that this should be dealt with, if that's helpful, to have staff look at it right away, but I don't want it buried in there with other things.
Okay. Let's call it a separate item then.
Okay.
And can the planning manager suggest some language that we could consider having it on the work program as a standalone item?
Let's do number 26, LUB, or OCP update, OCP review, sorry, let's call it OCP review, subdivision for a relative.
And I'd suggest that if you want action taken quickly, it would have to be at the very top of your work program and ahead of the other items that you've already prioritized. So is that a high for you, Trustee Grove?
It is, yes.
I agree
Trustee
with
Grant?
That.
Mm. Okay, yep. Great. All right, so, and there are no further items?
No.
Okay, so we have an awful lot of highs.
Yeah.
And quite a lot of mediums, too. Can I run through the highs as a starting point? I've got number 7, Watershed Management Plan. And let me just ask if you've changed your ranking from high, given the others. number 7 is high, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 23, 25, 26 are all highs.
So you're making that sound much worse than it is. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7, 8 items, correct?
I've got 9.
Okay, sorry, I guess let's get it done. Number 7, high. Number 15, high. 16, high. 17, high. 18 high, 19 high, 23 high, and now we've got this, 25 high, and now we've got this 26 high, that's correct. Yeah. Well, we've got 3 years, we've got, and some of these top priority at the top, we're going to be knocking off pretty quickly.
I love your optimism. Secondary suites and riparian area regulations, you think will be knocked off quickly?
Well, no, but those are two items.
We've got can I make a suggestion?
Please do.
That over the weekend or the early part of next week, we actually number these.
That's a good idea.
And the two trustees can send their numbers to staff, and then we try and...
Yes.
Have a rather more definitive priorities list than rather than simply high, medium, and low, and that will indicate a pecking order for these.
Yeah.
And the same with the mediums as well.
For all of them.
Yeah.
Is this document available in a form that we can manipulate it?
This was emailed to you by the planning manager.
Last week, is that right?
I think two weeks ago, yes.
Yeah.
So look under your
LIA. Yeah, but I can actually manipulate it with it on my computer. Mm-hmm.
Well, yes, it's a Word file.
Yeah. And just adding notes.
Okay, fine.
So it's possible.
Thanks.
So as I understand, the next action is that the trustees will send their ranking of the all of these to planning staff, and that will result in a work program report that will give a little bit of a reality check on how big each of these projects are and what might reasonably pair together and what what might be doable within a term. Okay. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I'm not. We're not asking you at this point to place it on a Gantt chart to say it will start now and end then. It's a little bit more of a how big of a project is this, and we trust you to be realistic because things always take longer than we think they will, and we always want to have buffers built in for the unexpected. These processes don't work well when we're rushing the public or our staff. So I really count on the considered advice of the planners, remembering that you're doing the mechanical, we're the ones doing the political community opinion, so we don't want you to sell short the technical work that needs to happen. Any thoughts or ideas on public consultation around this priority list? How does the trust committee want to work forward on engaging around whether?
Well, my thoughts are when we put together a program for town halls that we actually send that out to the community via either the Driftwood or some sort of online facility where they can list what their priorities would be in terms of holding those town halls and different subjects. And that might be a process through which we revise our work program priorities. In response to the community.
Yes, I mean, that, I'd see that as being part of the town hall process that we've been talking about.
Do you want to look at anything like a survey? I know SurveyMonkey and some of those tools are available. Is that something that you'd like some advice on at a following meeting around whether we can, and not everybody will necessarily come out to a meeting.
Yeah, they're all useful tools. We should use contemporary technology, no doubt about that. So I'd be open to using those sorts of devices as well.
And this is going to be a public document in any event, right?
Yeah, definitely. So any direction to staff that you want to give for next steps? And I'll just turn to the planning manager whether there's any direction you need.
Madam Chair, I think that it would benefit from a resolution which there's a recommendation on page 4, which I'm going to suggest be amended slightly, but I think that a resolution would provide certainty that you have directed staff to work with the same list together with one addition and to work with the discussion today to pursue the work program. So I can walk you through perhaps an amendment or do you want, try this on
for size? Why don't you read out what you think the resolution might be?
Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee directs staff to further develop the LTC work program comprised of projects contained in this report and in discussion today.
And does that capture also your forthcoming advice on resources that are available?
Yeah.
So that's just taken as a given?
Yes.
Does that direction resonate with the local trustees, and would anybody be willing to?
I can. This auto-correction is a bit of a nuisance. What was after program?
I've got
work program, chorused projects, but it's not that.
Comprise. I've got it.
Comprise, thank you. Okay, I'm happy to make the motion.
Okay.
Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee directs staff to further develop the LTC work program comprised of projects contained in this report and in discussion today.
And I will second that.
Is there any discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favour? That passes unanimously. Thanks very much to all the staff. That was really helpful.
Indeed.
And we know that work is carrying on our big top project, so I'm glad that we're taking the time to get the next steps. Part settled. We are now on page 5 of the agenda, item 3.2, and inviting
bylaw enforcement coordinator Miles Drew to present his report briefly.
And before he does that, I have another high priority project.
Okay, shall we recess for a moment?
Let's come back to order.
Reality.
Oh, come on.
It's 11:01, and we are on page 5 of the agenda, item 3.2, inviting bylaw enforcement coordinator Miles Drew to present his report on secondary suites enforcement advice.
Okay, so as they're reading the logs, I'll proceed as if people have read this.
Yes.
Yeah.
My first point I want to make is, on reading this, I have a concern that you might believe that bylaw enforcement has opinions that aren't in line with planning, and really they're quite close. Just that this particular report is designed to answer the question about these specific ideas vis-a-vis enforcement.
Right.
So my main point is that at the moment, suites are largely not permitted, yet they exist in a large scale. That whatever enforcement program we have around suites at the moment has been completely ineffective at getting general compliance with the bylaw. So my real point in this report is, if beyond permitting suites to exist, the goal of this type of restricted and specific legalization of the suites is to force existing suites to upgrade to meet building code and to restrict suites to only certain areas because of specific environmental or other problems in other areas, without implementing a proactive enforcement program, it will not achieve those goals.
Mm.
Right? So, because they already exist. In fact, you know, in the Malibu area, which is a sewage treatment area that's got concerns about overcapacity, my unscientific belief is that that's highly suitified at the moment. And my other point is that we're not in full control of all aspects of enforcement that can deal with suites. And that if we did choose to proactively enforce on whatever suite regulation that exists, be very much more effective. We were able to draw in the other agencies that are in control of the specific concerns. Because the color of right and wrong right indignation is easier to establish if you're doing it because there's an overcapacity in sewage rather than just that there's a bylaw that says you can't have them. Those are the concerns. And that we could develop enforcement programs with a policy attached that describes under what conditions we would enforce on the suite, even if there were a complaint, that type of thing.
Trustee Grove.
Right now, enforcement is based on a complaints made basis, or if conditions come to your attention or that you recognize are breaking rules or bylaws. Is that what happens now?
Well, at the moment, on suites, it's completely complaint based.
Right.
Except if we were aware of some major environmental problem, like a broken septic system or something like that. But then BHA just gets in there and orders a correction and that disappears. So it's a complaint driven.
I mean, I would hate that to change. I would hate to go into an active proactive program, which would take up a huge amount of your time, I would assume.
It would consume a lot of resources.
And
it would also come back, in my view, it would also come back to the LTC as an issue of complaint.
Right.
That's true.
You're still going to, complaints will still come to you, and you will deal with them on a complaint basis. And I would, so changing, legalizing these suites does a number of things, I think. First of all, recognizes what's happening anyway. So I find it in Congress to have a bylaw which everyone's, or a lot of people are breaking. It allows people who want to do it properly above board to get a building permit and to get registered. And those who run, who are breaking the bylaw, they're running a risk, of course, which they may choose to live with or not. I would be very reluctant to suggest a proactive pursuit of this.
One other thing, it seems to me that one of the proposals is that there's a grace period for suites to be registered. And it seemed to me from reading that initial report that the grace period was also a period in which the suites would be required to come up to grade before they would be considered legal.
But you'd have to get a building permit, right?
Yeah.
So.
Okay, so that might be something that we can start with.
So let's turn to the island planner, Justine Stark, just for a clarification on the staff recommendation.
The intent of the grace period would be to offer a window for those people with existing suites to register their suites and establish their existence, because under the scenario that's been proposed with pilot areas, allowing new suites in some areas, but also allowing existing suites everywhere they exist if they have put themselves on the list during this grace period. So that was an incentive for people with existing suites to say we have an existing suite, we're outside of a pilot area, and then the door would close and new suites would not be allowed outside of those pilot areas. So this is all designed as a way to move forward with the pilot area as a way of implementing the incremental objectives of the OCP. So it's definitely relies on the threat of enforcement as in order to incentivize people to comply.
Trustee Grimes.
So if I understand it, existing suites within water catchment areas would be accepted, despite the fact that they're outside the pilot area?
That's what staff have proposed.
Okay. I've been wrestling with this whole issue, and it needs resolved. I mean, we need to increase the quality of secondary suites and also do something about delinquency on island. At a time when we can provide no alternative housing, enforcement's a real issue because it's going to create some social problems. And this is so tied to affordable housing that I think we need a bank of affordable housing that people can move into, which will provide the opportunity for some of the existing suites to be made vacant. The legislation is needed. I think we've got to tread very carefully on the enforcement issues with this. It's by encouragement and persuasion rather than
yes.
than enforcement until we have adequate alternatives.
I would suggest then that suites that currently exist, I don't even know if the register idea is that practical from an enforcement perspective. I can't really see people willing to come forward enough to move forward now. But this would just be a common exercise to figure out why they're not lawfully not conforming. Right? So if we ran into a complaint situation. But so I think the idea of registering could still exist because it's going to be helpful information for the planner, et cetera. But I wouldn't key legalization on it. I'm talking from a pretty important perspective, right? And there's other reasons. Fortunately, I'm not the LTC, I don't have to balance all this stuff, right? Good reason to legalize existing suites is that if they're subject to complaint because of a low standard, the building inspector would be able to deal with that
right.
in a way other than just throw them out.
Right.
Right? He could say, well, you can't have this suite because it's dangerous. And then the reason that people would have to spend money, when they could save if they still wanted to have the rent for
Correct.
The suite, right? And that would improve the living conditions of people in it. At the moment, when we get a complaint about living conditions of a suite, which is a common reason for a complaint of a suite, the only option we've got is you're out of here.
Yeah. I think that's right.
Which makes people reluctant to complain about the living conditions they're in because they're complaining because they want to see some improvement. They still need a place to live.
That makes good sense to me. I must say I hadn't realized that you were proposing that we should legalize all existing suites, even if they're in within a watershed. That makes me a little anxious, and I'd be curious to know how others feel about that. I assumed we were talking about the two pilot areas. We were going to legalize them.
Yeah, and I put that out there, and I understand. That factor was one of the big reasons why we asked to consult more with the community, because I was getting the sense that there were a lot of suites in the watershed areas and that these suites might not have septic fields, for example, that are adequate to supply them. And they exist illegally now. They might very well exist illegally post a bylaw to allow secondary suites. And so we're just trying to achieve other objectives, like an improvement to the environmental conditions within the watersheds.
By controlling them.
By allowing them. And you could also design, in evaluating other communities, they have enforcement programs that are only enforced in scenarios where there's been a health concern or an environmental concern. So that would be, you might, for example, design an enforcement strategy that is a little bit different for the watershed areas than for other areas.
So that's precisely why I didn't put a proposal enforcement program in there, because I recognize that this probably, the enforcement program might even be incrementally developed for the purposes of nudging people towards this. For instance, it could be possible to say, in the areas that we haven't permitted them, and we haven't permitted them because we have these abiding concerns about over capacity of sewage or water catchment areas and all that stuff, be proactive about seeking out suites, but don't do enforcement on them if they're able to establish that they've got, adequate septic or something, like, you know what I mean? It's like, because you're allowed to customize enforcement for the sake of reducing resource consumption, that sort of thing, right? But I don't think at this point it's a good idea for us to talk about that too much, because it would too early send the signals about who's off the hook and who's on the hook. And our ideas are going to change as time goes by in this discussion anyway. And I'm afraid of the planners. No, because it's an extremely nuanced problem. Doubly nuanced when we're not in control of building inspection.
Trustee Grams.
I think registration is completely right. I actually like the way that you've constructed the outlines for this bylaw. My one concern is whether there will be a rush from people who don't have secondary suites within catchment areas to register them anyway, simply so they can keep the door open, or maybe sticking one in later on. And how do we police that? So do we check everyone that's registered? Do we inspect? And the process is important. I think it's imprudent to try and construct bylaw enforcement strategies until after we've had the community information meetings. So I would be cautious of recommending, as it says here, that we do that at the moment. I'd rather wait and then get the community input before we start forming the bylaw enforcement plans and policies.
Trustee Grams.
May I get clarification from Trustee Grams? So you're okay with allowing existing suites in watersheds at this point and allowing them to register?
I'd like to see the numbers, actually. I think that's one of the advantages of having the registration process. I think it is rightly a way through CRD or VHA in order to upgrade the standards if they're registered.
So one of the concerns I identified here is if you put yourself in the shoes of the suite owner, at the moment, he's immune from enforcement because no one's complaining. And because of the enforcement is largely ineffective, it's like they go to the kitchen and disappear, close it, and then it goes back in, right? So if registering is going to expose them to the risk of higher expense because they're going to have to take out a building permit and all the rest of it, yet there's no proactive enforcement seeking him out, the motivation for registration will, in enforcement perspective, will likely be exactly the same as it is at the moment to obey the bylaw, in other words, zero, right? So that's why I'm sort of suggesting that if we don't actually develop the enforcement program, we leave it clearly on the table. Because without this negative incentive, I can't see registration producing sufficient registrations to be useful information.
I'm not sure that I agree with that. If I had a property with a suite in that area, and I figure this is going to be my one and only chance to get my suite legalized, so I'm going to register it, because chances are, down the road, the additional suites are not going to be allowed in the watershed area. So this is going to be my one...
That's my view.
You have to be in the field to really get a feel for how clearly the idea is established that you can get away with having an unlawful suite.
Right.
You know, I mean, there are categories of people out there that will think like you, but I can tell you now that, you know, there's an overwhelming number of suites that are not legal. There's an overwhelming number of suites in duplexes. So you're dealing with fourplex, you know what I mean? It's like,
And that will happen. I'm sure that will happen. Mm-hmm. However, it will allow those who wish to legitimize themselves, and you're still going to, I mean, you're not going to be worse off than you are now, because the people who don't want to register are still going to be illegal one way or the other, and they still will be only dealt with on a complaints made basis.
My only point was, if you think registration without the threat of enforcement is going to produce sufficient numbers to
I think we do one step at a time.
Well, I also wouldn't make public, although we are here, that we're not threatening to enforce. I think we following the meeting, the community engagement meetings, we do put in place enforcement procedures and policies, and we decide on an implementation process, and I think most certainly we would have to look at health and safety issues, and possibly even first within watersheds, and take action. I think there's little point in constructing legislation that has no teeth.
Yeah. And another I'm sorry.
No, it's good.
One of the things Justine said to me yesterday was that sort of caught my attention, that was that some communities have extended registration periods, and it's possible that we could have a registration period if it didn't produce what we expected it to extend it, but announce at that time that, you know, a proactive enforcement program will be there. So, you know, you do have a chance to tweak as you go along.
I've got a couple of comments. One is just to clarify that what's going to the community information meeting is the program as proposed by the planner, and that does include suites within watersheds. We've sort of certified by resolution that we want that discussed by the community. Something that, and of course then depending on community input, then we can work with that further. Something I just think might be helpful for the trustees to keep in mind while you're going through those community information meetings is, what do you actually want to achieve as an outcome? My sense is that one of the benefits of ending up with legalized suites is that you have better rights for tenants. You have the landowner has better access to grants and so on to be able to do upgrades. but they're only legal if they get a building permit. So I think that it is going to be helpful to think about what's the end goal that you want, and that is going to inform the staff advice around how to implement. And I really take the bylaw enforcement officer's advice and the planner's advice really seriously.
Mm, right.
As you know, I'm concerned about the scope of the whole program, let alone the scope on the island, but I think it's very clear to for politically for you to be able to articulate the objective, because that's going to inform the tools. So I had a couple of just detailed questions that probably, I'm not sure if they're for the planner or for the bylaw enforcement coordinator, on page 5 of the agenda package around the recommendations on the regulatory requirements. So this is maybe an opportunity to ask, should we be including in the definition that a suite is something that has an occupancy permit or a building permit? Now, that is the mechanic of what's recommended in your approach, but I wonder if it's not included in the definition. Does that make it less enforceable or less clear to the public that they don't actually have a legal suite unless they have an occupancy permit?
That would be a decision to consider. That wasn't something that I was proposing. In that, there, it would enable people with suites time to bring their suite up to code. If we allowed it by zoning, and they know there's a double approval process, they have to go to CRD for a building permit, and CRD is necessarily going to have their own enforcement strategy could be coordinated with us or not, but they're going to, this is a work program for CRD as well, and so that's, I guess it's a political decision, maybe it's something to talk about with the community. I hadn't considered tying the zoning bylaw to the building permit requirement. It's a consideration.
I have a comment about that. That type of land use regulation, I would want to check first that we could even do it, because it seems to me that we might be moving out of our letter of patent into the CRD's letter of patent. But assuming that we were able to do it, it would mean that the CRD building inspection department, the way they're operating now, would come in across a suite that was unsafe, but didn't have an occupancy permit. They would automatically say, well, that's a land use issue because it's not a permitted use, and you need to enforce it to us. And then it would be in the position again of enforcing because it's a land use issue. And really, the rock of our nation is on the health and safety stuff. And, well, it's kind of a extraordinary way to pull in building code regulation into our sphere. It's not really a land use issue, it's only a land use issue because, you know, in a municipality, the council controls all of it, so they can tweak all together, right? So
it could just as well be addressed by an information note within the land use bylaw, so it was clear to residents. So
yeah, the double approval side.
The other question I wanted to ask, in the OCP it says, you know, ideally the this would be owner occupied. We know we can't do that, but the regulatory recommendation is that the owner occupies the principal dwelling or else has an authorized property manager agent to act on the owner's behalf. Is there any possibility of saying local property manager? I know we've done that through some of our vacation rental bylaws, and is that something that you've looked at or is a possibility to make sure that there's someone close by? I guess that's the intent.
Mm-hmm.
This is another aspect that I would really like to hear from the community on, and that I'm glad you brought up, because it was a way, I've also played with the wording, and you'll see it in some staff reports, like or owner's agent.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, these are all just ideas at this point, right? There's no draft bylaw. The intent of having it be a local property owner, so that you're not having off-island management of commercial properties, is that the concern?
Mm.
I think that's the flavor of the concern in the OCP policies.
Okay.
But I also appreciate that both from a local employment and also a local accessibility, having an agent that's on the island. In that case, you're not discriminating against, it can only be a Salt Spring resident that can own a suite. That's not the intention, but it's a, for neighbors who might have noise impacts or whatever, they would be able to signal to either the local owner or the local manager that there's a problem, and then the person's on the island and can come and remedy the situation.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
I just think that's very important.
Yeah, I like that.
It's policed on island.
Yes.
Yeah.
Local is an excellent word. Yeah.
No, that's great. The idea between having it be our owner's agent would be that, you know, that the neighbors would like that confidence to be able to know who to talk to if they're having an issue. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we do have many, many houses that are owned by.
I can just appreciate in this situation, because you're doing an intensified level of activity on the property, that to me feels like a reasonable trigger. So that may be something just to listen to more in the public consultation as well. Trustee Grant.
Well, I would just like to clarify that I'm completely clear in what I think the intention of the bylaw should be to try and achieve. But I think it's also really important that we articulate that goal to the community at the public information meetings, that these are what we are trying to achieve by that, and it's not simply to impose a regulatory framework for the sake of it, that there are targeted goals that we want to achieve, raise the standard of rental housing on the island, ensure that the numbers don't spawn exponentially and uncontrollably, and to alter the culture from one of delinquency to one of compliance. And they're the three essential aims that I see.
I would add to that protection of renters. It puts them in a more secure situation, both from a health and safety point of view, but
good
also
point.
Absolutely.
So that that is you know, certainly what I've heard so far is, is one of the drivers from the community perspective.
And that is what I was sure was one of the intents of the report written by the planner. And that's the difficulty that I wanted to highlight, is that if you operate on enforcement the way we're operating now, it might be difficult to achieve those. Right? So I just didn't want us to be naive.
No question.
Understood.
Absolutely.
If I could just say a final thing about the bylaw enforcement policy approach that that the coordinator is proposing. In the absence of that, the bylaw officer can go ahead and enforce on the complaints that he receives, and you don't have any influence on that. So the benefit of, at some point in time, adopting a bylaw enforcement policy is that you do then get to put your own filter on it.
Right.
Number one is health and safety, so on. And my sense is, and again, I'd encourage you just to keep your ears open through the public consultation, is that the prospect of any change does inevitably heighten people's concern or make them feel more vulnerable. And so a bylaw enforcement policy, even possibly earlier in the bylaw development process, may well reassure people who are living in illegal dwellings that they know what the criteria will be, and it may ultimately settle some of those fears, is my sense.
Those are all very good points. There's also one other additional point. It may also settle the fears of the people that are opposed to suites.
True.
Right?
Yeah, no, it should do.
We've had that experience with short-term vacation rentals, where people that are lending them to their uncles or second cousins got off the hook because they realized, well, you're not after us.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
In this case, it may be, while they're still after the people that are polluting the lake because of overcapacity of their septic field. You know, I don't want to prejudge what the enforced policy would be, but that's the other major usefulness of the policy.
It'll protect the environment, indeed. Yeah.
Good.
So my sense is that there isn't appetite at this point to move this resolution, to give that direction to staff.
Correct.
But you would welcome advice from the planner and the bylaw enforcement coordinator as to when's the right time. Is that fair?
I'm happy that the process begins, provided that it isn't crystallized until the benefit of receiving the input from the community.
And I would agree with that, provided we are relatively clear on what we're attempting to do and what this is. So, because I'm not sure that the public has that at this point. We need a draft.
So the recommendation says, should they result in amendments to bylaw 3.5? So what I've kind of crafted it to say, you're interested in hearing about an enforcement policy after the amendment is, you know, when you're further down the...
Yeah, we're actually asking for enforcement plans, and which could reflect what we've been discussing today. That's all we're asking for. Isn't that right? And
yeah,
so I see no problem with processing it, proceeding with this. This actually.
And they'd be in draft, so they would come back to the trust committee.
Yeah, it's just a proposal. And you've heard what we are thoughts.
They'll only come back when the planners, probably what I would see is after the planner's next steps and the planner's report to the LTC, then would be a time to act to, you know, send your signals on what kind of report you want from the bylaw enforcement committee.
I would have thought you could give us a draft proposal based upon our discussions today. No?
I would advise that would happen sort of maybe after first reading of a bylaw. So they're like right now there's ideas on the table, but until the local trust committee gives direction on actually what should the bylaw say and how should this whole thing be approached, then it might, once that happens, then there might be an opportunity to design some kind of enforcement strategy.
Because the problem is we're trying to do a bit of a dance here.
It's chicken and egg, isn't it?
We're trying to do a bit of a dance here about, we don't want people to feel so at risk of the risk of enforcement, they won't come and talk to you.
Right.
And we don't want people to feel they're completely off the hook so that they won't come and talk to you. Right? You know, so we'd rather just like...
So you'd like this to be put off?
I'd like to lurk in the background. So,
so you'd like this recommendation to be put on hold?
Recommendation wouldn't cause me to come to you next meeting.
No,
quite. Say, it basically tells, I think it tells me, wait till
so you're okay with it.
You ask for
all right, so I'm happy to make that motion.
So can I just check what I hear, though? I think I have heard that this is a fairly important piece of the public understanding of the bylaw. So if we did first reading of the bylaw, we would not be scheduling public hearing until perhaps at second reading, the next meeting 3 weeks down the line, we would receive the draft bylaw enforcement plan, be able to comment on it, make modifications, but then you wouldn't see that back again before public hearing necessarily. I think it's, if a draft plan came at time of first reading, you could provide comment and then deal with a final plan at second reading and have your public hearing.
Actually, that makes sense. Yeah.
Because people need to know the whole picture.
Quite so.
Yeah, so a draft plan at the same time as first reading. Draft plan at time of first reading, able to input on the draft plan and then have it revisited at second reading.
Can I just make a suggestion, though? In this case, remember that at this point, this is only a land use bylaw change that's recommended, not an official community plan.
Mm-hmm.
So you can conceivably turn the bylaw around, you know, quicker than sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm feeling from the planner that she's got the best sense of what the community feeling in and what some of the mechanics. And I appreciate completely that to ask the bylaw enforcement officer to finalize a bylaw enforcement policy without knowing what's in the bylaw is going to be awkward.
I agree.
So, and rushing this isn't going to work so far as your community input, let alone agency feedback. So personally, just knowing that this is going to be a sensitive topic, I'm not sure that you'd want to rush the public hearing anyway until you were sure people understood what was in the bylaw at first reading. And maybe that after the community information meetings, you may well have some revelations that you want to convey both to the planner and the bylaw enforcement officer, and it may be that this policy starts to get developed behind the scenes with your input, you know, so that the pieces come together. Planner Stark.
I'm not sure, and maybe I can be corrected, but I see a bylaw enforcement program as part of implementation of a bylaw that's been adopted, and I'm not sure it's necessarily information that needs to be at public hearing, because it's not the bylaw itself, it's part of the implementation. So a bylaw is written with the assumption that it will be enforceable.
Yes, I mean, sorry, we're kicking round and round. I'm not sure that I want to have a public debate as to how this is going to be enforced or not going to be enforced. I mean, what is it going to say? You know, we don't plan to pursue infractions of this bylaw. I mean, we're hardly going to say that. So I don't actually see that this is going to be an issue for debate. But somebody will say, how do you intend to enforce this bylaw?
There are two issues. The first one is we need to have the enforcement policy in place. That has to be explained and discussed to the community. But we needn't elucidate or articulate anything about whether certain parts are going to be implemented or enforced over others. That's the mechanism for enforcement we don't discuss, simply the policy and the actual structure of it. I think that has to be agreed with the community. The rest is sotto voce.
My sense is it's going to be hard to separate, and I do think that if the Trust Committee does pass this resolution, then we'll be relying on the staff advice around how the two can come together.
Fine.
And you'll be informed by the community input that you get.
And that's fine by me.
Yeah, me too.
So can we move on this?
Let's move this resolution, and if maybe after, on the third line, after options one and two, if you could insert the words on secondary suites so that the resolution can stand alone.
One and two on secondary, okay. So I move that the Salt Spring Island Local Trust Committee request bylaw enforcement staff to draft enforcement plans and policies designed to ensure that recommendations 1 and 2 and options 1 and 2 on secondary suites, should they result in amendments to bylaw 355, deliver their intended results.
Seconded.
Is there any discussion? Are you ready to vote? All those in favor? Passes unanimously. Thank you very much, team. Can we have a break until noon?